It's 5:45 p.m., which means it's time for BCTV's Nightly News Roundup. I'm Roland Boyden alongside Frederick the Noise. For all this time, I get your name wrong. Frederick, no, yes, no. We're doing a special edition here of 5:45 Live tonight, along with mispronouncing my coworker's name here. We'll have some stuff from Bernie on voter suppression. He was on Rachel Maddow's show. We'll talk about that. Melinda Busno, our thoughts go out to her. A figurative get well card from us for her. And the governor gets to talk to Obama when he was down this weekend for the Governor's Association. All that and more. We're going to do it in 15 minutes. Even if you have some attention span issues, try and stick with us.
What we want is the General Accountability Office to document such issues as how extensive is voter fraud in this country. My understanding is, thank goodness, it is not a serious problem at all. And I want to use that study to expose what the Republicans are doing.
Welcome back to this February 27th, 2012 edition of 5:45 Live. That's Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders on Rachel Maddow's MSNBC show, talking a little bit about new legislation that would require voters at the polls to show a positive photo ID, something he says is a form of voter suppression. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a sec. We've got some more footage, courtesy of his YouTube channel as well. But first, we'll welcome back Frederick Noyes to the desk, BCTV Access Coordinator. Second time, I believe.
Yes, indeed.
Doing the live game. Whole other way to do it. So
I have about 18% more voice than Joe Bushy. So
that's right, Joe. Yeah, running. Boy, all kinds of fevers and flu and everything running around here. So we're lucky to get even one person here at the desk. Anyway, we'll try and do our best with the show we got coming up tonight. I want to start, as I mentioned, sending a figurative get well card to longtime Brattleboro area drop-in center ED Melinda Busno, who suffered a serious heart attack on Saturday. I believe she was swimming at the Colonial Motel. Sounds like she got help immediately, though it was very severe. She's now at Brattle Memorial Hospital in stable condition. We're told friends and family are all around her. And of course, she does such good work in the community that it sounds like so many people have been calling the hospital to wish her well that the staff is completely overloaded. So they're saying it's great for your concern, showing your caring, but please refrain from calling the hospital immediately until more word is out. They're just getting completely overwhelmed, obviously. Means a lot to this community. Her job, really more of a lifestyle, I would say, than just a job. She's been known
definitely to. Definitely a full immersion type of occupation. And this community is going to miss her in her absence. And, of course, everyone's wishing her a speedy return to health and returning to the office to help those folks in need.
Yeah, it's a little scary to think what the drop-in center is without her. She's dedicated. She's been working there longer than I've been alive, so it's been a long run for her. We wish her, as you just mentioned, a speedy recovery. She was in here not a month ago to talk about Governor Shumlin's new plan to combat homelessness. We've got a clip of that. Let's take a look.
All of us are only a few paychecks away from the people that are homeless now. And they're folks that are working full-time jobs. They're young families. They are people who are disabled. They are people who are senior citizens who've worked and paid taxes all their lives, and they cannot make ends meet, and they need help with food. And sometimes we can help prevent the homelessness by helping them to stretch that food budget and use what little money they have to pay for heat, to pay rent, and get food from us.
Next, over the weekend, Governor Peter Shumlin traveled to Washington, D.C. to attend the National Governors Association winter meeting, and seizing the opportunity to bend the president's ear on everything from boosting jobs in Vermont to increased LIHEAP funding and new Irene relief programs for 2013. He also used that opportunity to discuss the creation of a high-speed rail corridor that would run through Vermont, passing from New York to Montreal.
In an interview following the conference, Shumlin told the Vermont Press Bureau that, quote, and as I do the quote, let's put it up on the screen. I came out of that meeting feeling like the president is focusing like a laser on job creation. He gets that link that we are working so hard on in Vermont. That's the quote coming off of the Vermont Press Bureau about his time down there, getting to hang out with Obama. All right, we'll move on. With 2017 listed as the earliest Vermont could have single payer in the state here, they continue to work on the latest universal health care stopgap known as the Exchange, which would allow, among other things, Vermont's nearly 16,000 small businesses to buy into federally subsidized health care plans for their employees. If Vermont can get enough people into the exchange, they could see up to $350 million in subsidies and tax credits from the feds. At last week's press conference, Governor Shumlin discussed the effectiveness of the health care exchange.
I have long advocated that one of the biggest obstacles to job growth in Vermont is the inability for employers to afford the rising cost of health insurance. It stifles job growth, it stifles investment, it stifles raises given to employees. It is killing business, the rising cost of health care. This exchange will allow employers to get out of the health care business and allow their employees to get federal subsidies by buying directly in the exchange.
Police are looking for an individual unidentified who took an undisclosed amount of money from the Gulf station on Canal Street yesterday afternoon around 3 p.m. This comes just weeks after the nearby Neighbors gas station was victimized by a series of armed robberies.
Next, we mentioned Bernie and his time on Rachel Maddow's show. I want to go back to that clip in a second, and he's talking about new legislation, which is going to require people to show photo ID at the polls. Many states are already putting this in place, not federal legislation, state legislation, but he's working to make it a federal mandate that this doesn't happen, because I think sometimes people forget how many people out there don't have a photo ID. I mean, it's, you know, we all have our driver's licenses, passports, everything like that. But if you are not somebody that drives, has access to a car, perhaps you're elderly, you never got a passport, this can be really tricky. And especially, you know, we've seen examples in this state of how hard it is to get people to the polls in the first place.
Yeah.
So to anything that kind of stands in the way of that, this sounds like of concern to Bernie Sanders. Here he is talking to Rachel Maddow.
I have heard people who studied this issue say that as many as 21 million Americans may not have the ID that Republicans are trying to require to vote. Do you think that these laws are so sweeping that they could affect the outcome in national elections?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, what you're talking about is sometimes we forget, you know, not everybody is middle class. There are a lot of poor people who do not own cars, who do not have driver's licenses. A lot of old people don't drive as well. They do not have, in many cases, government-issued IDs.
All right, moving on. Friday's Union Institute and University annual Piapalooza, part of the Winter Carnival, yielded some delightful delicacies with local contestants battling for top honors for their homemade desserts. We've got the results for that here. Linda King's Rose Fresh Fruit Tart Pie took first place. Beth James' Blueberry Cheese Pie in second place. And Ted Dara of Chelsea Royal had a Peach Melba Pie that the judges felt warranted a third place ticket. Among the judges was Tim Johnson, WTSA reporter and occasional 545 Live video contributor.
And noted pie lover.
I've certainly suspected that of him, but now he's confirmed his love of pie. So that's about all I got for headlines for us here today, but I want to make sure we have just a little bit of time to look at the weather. Of course, traffic, my new favorite thing. That's what's up on the screen behind us here. If we take a look at what's going on with downtown, you know, as I fired this screen up, maybe I can put it on the screen for people at home that whose eyesight does not, including mine, allow for this TV, even though it's directly behind me. You know, I was looking at this strip, and actually, just in the last couple minutes while we were talking, we did get a lane cleared up downtown. The code, if anybody has missed a few 545 Live episodes in the past. Red is standstill traffic, orange is moving but heavily congested, and green is good to go. So some interesting splits in terms of the directions on the road here. If you're on south on between High Street and Canal Street, it's deadly, as it seems like it often is. If you go on north on Putney Road, though, you got the green light. And that's true going west on High Street as well. 91 traffickers are good to go, as they so often are, and everything else is in the orange. So again, heavy traffic, heavy volume, but it is moving. That's our high-tech traffic report powered by INRIX and Beat the Traffic. I want to just touch on weather a little bit too. Rumor has it that Wednesday could be a raucous day for the snow fairies.
Maybe a last gasp of winter, the non-winter that we've been having.
Yeah. Well, I know my good friend Joe Bushy, who often co-hosts here, is hoping for snow. He, I think, has economic ties to it, as he has quite a plow route. Anybody with economic ties to the snow is hurting this season for sure. Let's take a look at the forecast here. What do we got? A partly cloudy thing going on for tonight, mostly sunny tomorrow, and then Wednesday, that snow we were talking about, lows of 29. That snow is going to continue through the night into Thursday, when it'll turn into sun, and then Saturday we're going to get rain. Hard to believe that February and now March is just going to yield so much sun and rain and temperatures in the 40s, but that's what it looks like. We'll get sun through the better part of next week. All right, that's about all I got. Frederick, thanks for joining me back at the desk, filling in. It's been enjoyable. I feel pretty terrible about mispronouncing your name at the beginning of the show, but...
We've only known each other a short time.
All right, a few notes before we wrap up. Tonight at 7, the Brattle Memorial Hospital is hosting the lecture, I Googled It, So It Must Be True, The Benefits and Perils of Online Medical Research. And BCTV viewers can tonight enjoy BUHS-TV's Return from Winter Break. That shows in just minutes at 6 p.m. right here on Channel 8. All right, that does it. Making it a full lid, as I like to say. But remember, we're coming back Wednesday right here on Channel 8 at 5:45 p.m. We'll get all the usual hijinks, traffic, weather, headlines, and more. So be sure to tune us in. In the meantime, for BCTV, Frederick Noyes, and 5:45 Live, I'm Roland Boyden, and we're saying night, everybody.
Happy birthday, Ralph.
The two heroes, two of four heroes responsible for saving a major accident in the life of a dog. We're now in an empty parking spot.
This was the parking spot.
But tell us what happened.
Well, we pulled up here to let someone out of the car.
We were in that car.
We noticed that the car was slowly drifting back.
A different car with a dog in it.
And then we screamed and jumped out and pushed the car forward. And then you ran to the police station. And then I held on to your briefcase, because I know that that's good.